हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू सिविल दुनिया। दिस वन इज मॉड्यूल 3 ऑफ आवर सीरीज ऑन एनवायरमेंटल जियोटेक्निक। टुडे वी विल कवर सिलेक्शन ऑफ वेस्ट डिस्पोजल साइट्स, फैक्टर अफेक्टिंग साइट सिलेक्शन, साइटिंग क्राइटेरिया एंड साइटिंग रेटिंग मेथड। Second part of this video is landfills for municipal and hazardous waste, in which we learn components of landfills layouts. And in the next video, we will going to learn daily sales, baselining systems, stability of slopes, and constructing aspects. So let's get started with module 3. Landfill. What do you mean by landfill? Landfill is the general term used for structures which are specifically designed, constructed, and operated for accepting solid waste. By etymology, landfills, LF, are below ground level. Often, however, these structures are above original ground level, forming a land ridge, LR. In general, such a structure is partly below and partly above ground level. The abbreviation LF or LR is hereafter used to refer to any morphology of a landfill. Before the passage of environmental regulations, wastes were dumped indiscriminately in open areas with no care for the environment. Many countries have developed stringent regulations on waste disposal and landfills in the last few decades. Today, landfills are engineered structures that are aimed at containing the wastes effectively. Upon stabilization of municipal solid waste, the landfill sites may be used for a beneficial purpose such as golf course, recreational park, industrial park, and other such uses. Steve, in 1986, proposed the concept of a multi-barrier system for landfills based on the following: the subsoil, the geological barrier, a basal liner and capping, the technical barrier, the waste body itself, the control of landfill performance, and aftercare or post-closure plan. Waste separation and pre-treatment. The waste body is affected by waste collection. A separate collection is more favorable than an assortment of non-separated collected waste. Even more important is the pre-treatment of waste, which can serve several goals. It is advantageous if processes that convert the waste into a less reactive form proceed before landfillings. In an ideal situation, the aim is to obtain inert materials before landfillings. Pre-treatment reduces the amount of waste, which is particularly beneficial because landfill is becoming increasingly scarce. Pre-treated waste can often be used for new purposes, such as energy generation, or it can be recycled. There are thermal, biological, chemical, and physical pre-treatment procedures. Thermal pretreatment is quantitatively the most important. TI municipal waste requires municipal waste to be deposited with a maximum of 5% of organic components. To adhere to this limiting value, incineration is often the only possibility. The heat generated by incineration can be used for energy generation. The solid residues, namely slag and ash, may provide raw materials for building purposes. Biological pretreatment can be aerobic or non-aerobic. Aerobic biological pretreatment is known as composting, and anaerobic is known as fermentation. Biological pretreatment exhibits great potential for waste reduction. The biological mechanical pretreatment aims at the degradation of organic pollutants, a reduction in the quantity, and better compactability. Landfill mining is a method of treating old landfills. After eliminating emission sources, the waste body is excavated. The remaining waste compacted and useful materials are separated and recycled. As a result, landfill void space is increased, pollution potential reduced, and financial gains are achieved by material utilization. Now we will going to learn landfill concepts. Landfill classes are defined by the type and concentration of pollutants in the waste, and accordingly, different design standards are required. In Germany, the standards for hazardous waste are defined by TI hazardous waste, and those for municipal waste by TI municipal waste. These two documents set the limits for various waste strength parameters and for some 20 pollutants in the leachate. The landfill classes thus defined, characterized by, for example, the permitted nickel contained in the leachate, are as follows in order of increasing potential risk. Municipal solid waste landfills. Class 1, virtually inert waste, example nickel content is less than 0.2 mg per liter. Class 2 is waste with higher pollutant contents, example nickel content is less than 1 mg per liter. Hazardous solid waste landfills, example nickel content is less than 2 mg per liter. If the waste fails to meet the requirements for hazardous solid waste landfills, it must be incinerated or disposed of underground. Landfills may also be classified based on the waste composition and operations as inert material landfill, containment landfill, reactor landfill, and co-disposal landfills. First one is inert material landfill. In an ideal case, the inert material landfill contains only wastes that are neutral concerning emission and do not change the natural background concentration. Second one is containment and reactor landfills. Landfill strategy can be of the containment type and reactor type. Containment means an isolation from environmental effects and in particular water. For this purpose, the waste body is generally provided with liners. The capping protects the waste body from precipitation, while the basal liner adds the collection of leachate, which is then transported to treatment. In contrast, the reactor landfill encourages the process which in an ideal case produces an inert content, which is stable under environmental conditions and releases no pollutants to the environment. One will be able to reach such a state only in exceptional cases. When landfilling untreated municipal waste, a certain quantity of water has to be added to enable biological degradation process. Otherwise, the organic components may become mummified when water is added. Mummification can be interrupted or replaced by biological degradation process. In old deposits, the biochemical process may be interrupted if a subsequent containment obstructs the access of water. A leaky capping may entail an uncontrolled inflow of water and uncontrolled reactions. In such cases, it may be reasonable to feed water purposefully into old dry deposits to accelerate the biochemical reactions to bring them to completion within the operational time of the landfill. The biological process go through an aerobic and an anaerobic phase. In these phases, both gas develops, example methane, and organic pollutants accumulate in the leachate. At the end of the process, the landfill content is mineralized. The landfill operator is interested in encouraging the biological degradation so that it is finished within the active aftercare phase, which is 50 to 100 years. If the waste body has reached the mineralized state, it still contains inorganic pollutants. Example, heavy metals, of which only a limited amount is supposed to be released. For all these reasons, containment and reactor landfill are not necessarily contradictory strategies, since the bioreactor needs a liner to protect the environment and a capping and irrigation system to control the inflow of water and to minimize leachate production, the treatment of which is very cost intensive. However, in bioreactor landfills, the question of repercussion of elevated temperatures on performance of technical barriers has to be considered carefully. Co-disposal landfill. The UK Department of the Environment define co-disposal as a calculable and supervised treatments of industrial and commercial liquid and solid wastes in interaction with biologically degradable waste in a controlled landfill. If co-disposal is to have advantages, the basic materials must be exactly defined and mixed with one another in a controlled way. The mixing process must produce as homogeneous a product as possible. Sewage sludge and industrial sludges often contain so much water that they are not stable. The addition of municipal waste can yield a consistency which makes landfilling possible. Mixing harbor mud with clay, lime or cement may produce a stable material that can be landfilled. Mono landfills should be used to avoid inhibition of biological process in municipal waste by industrial pollutants. Co-disposal is outlawed in many countries today. Landfill phases. Landfill phases are important to distinguish for landfill construction and operation. Phase 0, that is basal liner construction. Phase 1, before filling wastes, the basal liner is fully or partially exposed. Phase 2, period of waste filling. This phase ends with the construction of the capping and the reclamation layer. Phase 3A, aftercare, part 1. It lasts 50 to 100 years. No more construction measures take place. Drainage and monitoring facilities are operated and maintained. Phase 3B, aftercare, part 2. Unlimited in time, aging of components of the liner systems occurs, impairing their effectiveness. Landfill liners. Generally, landfills must be provided with a composite basal liner and a capping, both of which are composed of sealing, protective and drainage layers, although alternative liners with proven barrier equivalence can be used. The capping system's main function is to prevent gaseous pollutant emission into the atmosphere and rainwater from percolating into the landfill so as to keep leachate generation to a minimum, while basal liners must protect the surrounding soil and groundwater from leachate pollution. Both the sealing layers are overlain by a drainage system, which in the basal liner collects leachate and transports it to a treatment plant to be cleaned of pollutants and subsequently discharged in the nearby surface water. A capping drainage layer collects rainwater, which requires no processing before being released. Composite liners. The basin liner and capping system for class 2 of municipal waste, according to TI Municipal Waste, the most important elements of this system is the composite liner, consisting of several lifts of earthen material with a minimum thickness of 0.25 meter of each lift and a minimum certified geomembrane of 2.5 mm thick. The geomembrane is installed on top of the earthen layer in intimate contact with it and is protected by a protective layer against damage by gravel or aggregates in the drainage layer. Liners for Class 1 municipal solid waste landfills differ in as much as no geomembrane is required and the minimum total thickness of the earthen layer is only 0.5 meter, while basal liners in hazardous waste landfills are similar to those for class 2, except that the earthen layer must be a minimum 1.5 meter thick. The permeability of the earthen layer of basal liners for all classes and in the capping system of hazardous solid waste landfills must be K less than 5 into 10 to the power minus 10 meter per second, and for class 2 capping systems K is less than 5 by 10 into 10 to the power minus 9 meter per second. Composite liners are required according to TI Hazardous Waste and TI Municipal Waste. One of their most important properties is the synergistic effect, whereby the combined effect of the earthen layer, also called mineral or clay layer, and geomembrane is greater than the sum of the effects of the individual components. The properly installed and welded geomembrane is an effective barrier against convection. Pollutants can only permeate it by diffusion. The rate of diffusion for various chemicals varying widely. For heavy metal ions and other inorganic materials, the geomembrane is virtually a perfect barrier, although water can diffuse through it to some small extent. Hydrocarbons and chlorohydrocarbons can slightly penetrate geomembranes and diffuse through them. However, they will then sorb within the earthen layer. Any further transport is only then possible by diffusion based on conservative assumptions on organic pollutant concentration at the landfill base. Breakthrough times of 16 to 18 years were obtained, indicating that the first pollutant molecule only reaches the lower surface of the earthen layer after this period of time, assuming a steady supply of pollutants. The long-term durability of geomembranes cannot be quantified exactly, since it strongly depends on the quality of the individual product chosen. The minimum period of time of full efficacy is often given as 50 years. However, geomembranes of well-stabilized and highly stress crack-resistant high-density polyethylene HDPE resins are likely to remain intact for several hundred years. Most importantly, geomembranes exhibit their full protective function in the active aftercare period when pollutant concentrations in the leachate are the highest. Earthen sealing layers are generally assumed to maintain their efficacy as basal liners over geological periods of time, even under chemical attack. However, they are likely to fail as capping liners in the long run. Since earthen materials are never absolutely watertight, small amounts of pollutants will permeate over longer period of time. The construction of the composite liners to meet the prescribed strict standards, in particular ensuring high quality intimate contact between the geomembrane and earthen layer, represents a great challenge to construction companies. In order to solve this complex problem, general quality management systems closely defining building procedures are required. Alternative liners. Instead of composite liners, alternative liners can be used if they can prove to be equally effective as composite barriers. Some of the alternative liners currently in use are as follows. Mineral liners. The statutory requirement for not less than 20% of fines less than 2 micrometer and not less than 10% of clay minerals in the earthen layer is very often difficult to meet. Therefore, equivalent earthen materials of different compositions are also used. Well-graded materials have grain size characteristics approximating Euler's curve, that is, their stable structure and only a small fines content is required to achieve low permeability. This type of liner exhibits less shrinkage on losing water, but they are not as flexible as earthen materials with a high clay content, and this can be a disadvantage in the event of differential settlement. DYWIDAG drag liners consist of 8% bentonite and 2 well-graded sand and gravel fractions. They yield an extremely high dry density, and on the addition of water, they tend to swell, that is, volume increase, thus cracks in the liner will not be expected. Multiple liner with a sorption layer. A multiple liner is composed of two layers with principally different functions. One of these serves as containment, that is, to prevent pollutants from leaving the landfill, and the other's function is to minimize the consequences of pollution should containment measures fail. Improved mineral liners. Silica glass, quaternary ammonium compounds, mountain wax, and other additives can provide high levels of imperviousness even in the absence of the clay fraction in the earthen material, and flexibility can even be greater than that of pure mineral mixtures. Silica glass combined with silence has been used successfully to improve cutoff materials. Silicon carbon bonds in organosilane hydrogel modifiers are extremely resistant to biochemical degradation. Recently, polymer amended sand bentonite mixtures have proven to be an alternative to compacted clay liners in capping systems. Asphalt liners. Asphalt is composed of a well-graded grain skeletal, a filler rock floor, and a bitumen. Based on experience in hydraulic engineering, liner systems incorporating asphalt are increasingly being used in Switzerland. More than 20 landfills have been constructed with asphalt liners. In Germany, a combination of a mineral layer directly overlain by an asphalt liner is preferred. Short-term tests have shown asphalt liners to be a good barrier to the convective transport of aqueous solutions while their stability and resistance to heat, weather, and penetration are advantageous features. A liner made of asphalt concrete in accordance with the requirements is almost impermeable to water and gas. It is very robust against mechanical stresses and desiccation is irrelevant. However, it is susceptible to chemical attack by hydrocarbons, and concentrated hydrocarbons can virtually destroy it. Geosynthetic clay liners. Geosynthetic clay liners are also known as bentomats. एंड दे जनरली कंसिस्ट ऑफ बेंटोनाइट सैंडविच्ड बिटवीन टू जियोटेक्सटाइल लेयर्स विच आर नीडल्ड और शिवन टुगेदर टू प्रोवाइड शियर स्ट्रेंथ. वाटर सैचुरेटेड बेंटोनाइट एग्जिबिट्स एक्सट्रीमली लो परमिएबिलिटी एंड इन प्रिंसिपल ए बेंटोमैट विथ ए फ्यू मिलीमीटर्स थिकनेस इज कैपेबल ऑफ प्रोड्यूसिंग द रिक्वायर्ड बैरियर फंक्शन फॉर प्रैक्टिकल रीजन्स. थिकनेस ऑफ ए फ्यू सेंटीमीटर्स आर यूज. बेंटोमैट्स कैन बी मैनुफैक्चर्ड इंडस्ट्रियली एंड इंस्टॉल्ड इन रॉल्स सिमिलर टू लेइंग टेक्निक्स फॉर जियोमेम्ब्रेन्स. दे आर लाइट ईजी एंड क्विक टू ले एग्जिबिट लो ससेप्टेबिलिटी टू सेटलमेंट एंड आर ईजी टू रिपेयर. हाउएवर रूट पेनिट्रेशन इज ए पोटेंशियल रिस्क. कैपिलरी बैरियर्स. कैपिलरी बैरियर्स कंसिस्ट ऑफ एन अपर फाइन ग्रैंड कैपिलरी लेयर एंड लोअर कोर्स ग्रैंड कैपिलरी ब्लॉक. कैपिलरी मेंसिस्कि आर फॉर्म एट द इंटरफेस बिटवीन द अपर एंड लोअर लेयर बाय वाटर परकोलेटिंग इन टू द अपर लेयर कैपिलरी फोर्स ऑन दीज मेंसिस्कि एंड वेरी लो अनसेचुरेटेड परमिएबिलिटी इन द कैपिलरी ब्लॉक prevent water from penetrating the coarse grained layer. Capillary barriers are almost insusceptible to desiccation and subsidence. Both the sand used for the capillary layer and the gravel used for the capillary block must be well graded, their optimum layer thickness being 0.4 meter and 0.3 meter respectively, and a minimum slope gradient of between 1:10 and 1:5 is advisable. Capillary barriers are most effective when used in combination with a gas tight sealing layer, example geomembrane or asphalt, and they are most often used on sloping areas of landfill caps. Component functions. The 24-inch thick soil barrier protection layer and the overlying 6 inches of vegetated topsoil protect the underlying geomembrane and promote evapotranspiration and runoff of precipitation. A 60 mil that is 0.06 inch thickness or 40 mil that is 0.04 inch thick, depending on the type of material used, geomembrane along with the underlying low permeability clay layer from a composite barrier cover system which prevents infiltrating rainwater from reaching the solid waste buried in the landfill and generating additional leachate. The gas veining layer collects the controls landfills gases generated by the decomposing waste mass. The waste mass may be greater than 150 feet thick. The primary leachate collection and removal system consists of a series of drains and pipes within a layer of sand or gravel designated to collect all of the liquid leachate which has drained through the waste mass. A 60 mm thick geomembrane underlies the leachate collection system on the bottom of the landfill. The 60 mil geomembrane is underlain by a clay layer or GCL, a thin manufactured layer of very strong textiles and extremely low permeability clay component to make a composite liner. The collected leachate is sent to a wastewater treatment plant. The landfill secondary leachate collection and removal system is a backup series of drains and pipes within a layer of sand or gravel designed to collect any leachate which was not contained by the primary liner system. A 60 mil that is 0.06 inch thick geomembrane underlined by a 24 inch thick clay layer comprises the secondary composite liner system which acts as secondary containment for leachate. This design serves to protect the environment from contaminants which may be present in the municipal solid waste. The landfill sheeting plan, which prevents the siting of landfills in environmentally sensitive areas as well as on-site environmental monitoring systems, which monitor for any sign of groundwater contamination and for landfill gas provide additional safeguards. If you gain some knowledge from this video, please like this video and subscribe Civil Duniya. Stay tuned with this channel for more videos on environmental geotechnic. And if you want to PDF of this video, please visit our Telegram channel Civil Duniya. Thanks for watching.